Hi everyone, Heather here with astrologywithheather.com, and I am back today with another special video. And today we're going to be discussing a topic that is super interesting to me, which is medical astrology. And so the way that I'm going to format this video is that I'm going to talk about medical astrology a little bit more broadly in terms of how it's generally used and how I personally utilize it in my own astrology practice. And then we're going to get into some of the main indicators for general overall health when it comes to astrology. So some of the very first things I would look at in somebody's chart just to determine whether or not they're generally more prone to good health and they have an easier time maintaining their health and vitality versus somebody who has to work a little bit harder at it. And so that's what we're going to be getting into today. So before we get into any of that, I just want to mention that medical astrology is not utilized to diagnose or cure people. That's not what I'm attempting to do in this video. This video is for educational purposes only. And in modern times, for the most part, medical astrology is utilized to kind of provide additional layers of insight when it comes to physical illness. And so what I mean by that is astrology in general is a technical, like, art form or science or whatever you want to call it, that gives us a little bit of a roadmap to what's going on in our lives and why and how everything is connected. Astrology is essentially what connects everything to everything else, right? You can see all sorts of things. There are so many different layers of what you can pull from the birth chart. One certain placement in your birth chart might indicate certain aspects. Let's say your moon, right? The moon can indicate psychological issues, your subjective reality, your emotions, your inner world, your sense of intuition. It can indicate specific energies around your mother and your experience of the mother in childhood. It can indicate energies around home and family, your own nurturing capabilities. It can very literally translate to things about property and home ownership. And it's also a general significator in traditional astrology of the body, the physical body. And so as you can see, it shows how all of these things are somehow connected, right? They're connected through this energy of the moon and what it represents. And so this is where sort of the medical astrology component comes in, because you can see during times of physical illness, based on what was activated in the chart, usually you can kind of tell what's going to be activated based on what the person tells you. You can see other layers of, you know, psychological issues, behavioral patterns, circumstances throughout somebody's life, traumatic events even that might have been tied to in some way, or in maybe an indirect way, they might be connected to the eventual development of illness. And so looking at astrology is just another supplemental thing that you can kind of incorporate into a holistic picture of what somebody is experiencing when it comes to physical illness, but it's not something that you use to diagnose people. And I certainly wouldn't want somebody to watch this video and then just randomly start diagnosing people with illnesses, because that doesn't work that way, and that would be completely unethical. So don't do that. I don't think you guys will, but, you know, just kind of as a side note there. And so astrology shows how everything is connected to everything else, and it shines a light on maybe some additional factors that we might not have been looking at otherwise when it comes to our own experience with illness. Another thing that astrology can do is it can show you periods of activation where you might have a more difficult time with your health. And so in my own personal experience, you know, I'm not shy about the fact that I suffered from chronic illness for roughly 8 years. I had a very specific period in my zodiacal releasing from the Lot of Fortune that indicated that that would be one of the most difficult times in my health. And then I had a whole bunch of different activations that happened all at once through transit and through other different timing techniques. And so it was like the perfect storm of things. And so when we do talk about what's going on in the chart in terms of the general overall constitution of a person, whether they're more, you know, healthy and strong, or if they have a little bit more difficulty when it comes to their physical body, just know that even if you have some of these indications of weakness. It doesn't mean that it'll ever become fully activated. And you have to have kind of like the predisposition and then some sort of external factor through the planetary alignments or through different timing techniques. Usually you have to have more than one activation occurring at the same time. So it does have to be like that perfect storm to initiate some sort of health crisis. And so that's something that I'll see time and time again when people come to me. And when people do come to me, it's not like they're like, I have an illness diagnosis. That's definitely not a thing. And I don't predict illnesses like, oh, you're going to have an illness at this time. But if somebody comes to me and they're concerned about their health because they've had a specific diagnosis, then looking at the timing of the onset can give a lot of information about what was being activated and how these things are connected to other areas of the chart and other areas of a person's life. And so those are things that you can kind of look at. And so that's kind of something to just kind of take as a side note. It doesn't mean that you're going to necessarily have a health crisis. And if you do have a lot of these indicators in your chart, like all of them that indicate that you're going to have a little bit of a harder time with your health, you probably already know that. You probably already understand that you're somebody who has to be more careful about what you eat and the way that you treat your body and things like that, your stress levels maybe, than other people might have to do. And we all know people in our lives who, do everything right and they're very health conscious and they seem like they're always sick or dealing with this thing or the other thing, or maybe they have some sort of chronic illness. And it's kind of like, well, why would that be? On the other hand, we know probably at least one person who treats their body like garbage. Like they just don't seem to care. They can eat whatever they want. They, you know, don't exercise. They drink, they smoke, they do whatever. And, they're still healthy. They're like super healthy and super energized. And it's like, how is that even possible? You're doing all of these things and you keep on going and you seem like you're fine. Well, astrology can provide some sort of answers for that. And so some people will be more predisposed to having good health regardless of what it is that they're doing to take care of their bodies. And so they'll have an easier time. They won't have to worry about it as much. And other people will be more predisposed to, having weaknesses in certain areas. And maybe they need to support their bodies a little bit more through supplements, diet, exercise, that type of thing, being more mindful of the way that they take care of themselves. And so that's kind of what we're looking at here in this video. Is like, what are the general indicators, the first things that I might look at to assess somebody's overall health and wellness throughout like their entire lifespan, really. And so, and then you kind of go in and look at specific things that could, be attributed to whatever it is that they're experiencing. And for me personally, just before we get into this, just to kind of give you my background and what I've been doing with this over the past few years is, so I've basically been studying medical astrology since I started studying astrology. I started studying astrology when I was in graduate school for clinical psychology, and I found the psychological implications incredibly fascinating. But I was also sick at that time, and I was not getting answers from the mainstream medical establishment. I was mostly getting things that made me worse or that scared the crap out of me and didn't help anything. So I was looking already into alternatives, and I was keeping an open mind, and I was really open to just whatever could give me more information and insight into what was going on with my health. And so as soon as I started studying astrology, maybe a few months later, I learned that medical astrology was even a thing. And I started looking into it and became interested in that. And so based on like my background in psychology, I've always been looking at things like, depression, anxiety, psychosis, like things that are termed as mental illness in the birth chart. Again, I don't diagnose people with things. If they come to me and they have these experiences, I can give them additional insight because I have a lot of knowledge around that. The other thing that I'm really good with is looking at chronic illness in the birth chart, because that is something I've experienced. I've researched very heavily. And a lot of times these things are interconnected as well. The brain and the brain and the body are not separate. They work synergistically. The brain controls what the body is doing when it comes to the functions of the organs and your immune response and your endocrine system and all of that. So there's no real separation there. And so you can kind of look at all these different layers with the astrology. And so that's something that I became really fascinated about. And especially over the past few years. I'm not sure exactly when I started like very seriously studying medical astrology, but it was definitely a few years ago. I've been really looking at these things very intensely, and it's helped me to gain insight into my own personal experience. And it's also, I believe it's helped some of my clients as well. But it's not something I was doing exclusively. Like, I wasn't doing medical astrology readings. It's just people come to me, they have these certain issues and complaints, and I know exactly what to look for. So I'm going to look for that and help them. And so now I'm doing this more actively and, you know, incorporating it much more into my practice with my clients, working one-on-one and things like that. But again, I'm not a medical practitioner. I always, you know, make sure that they're getting help elsewhere. And, I know, you know, maybe who to refer them to about different things. And so I don't do things that are outside of my scope of understanding and practice. So that's kind of what I do in the way that I operate. And again, it's just for informational, like educational purposes. It's kind of like if you were to Google information about your illness, right? Except I'm telling you things that you wouldn't otherwise be able to have access to because you maybe don't understand how that works with the astrology. And so that's my little spiel about that. And so there are a few things. So let's get into the bulk of this presentation and the actual like information that you guys are probably waiting for here, which is, how do you determine that person who's going to be super, super strong and like vital and energized and have a really strong body and constitution versus somebody who's a little bit weaker, who's more prone to illness? Maybe they have a lot of allergies, they experience autoimmune conditions, chronic illness, or they have some sort of major health crisis in their life that, you know, takes center stage at some point. Or maybe they just, you know, in general, their energy is a little bit lacking and they have to do a lot more to support their bodies. So how do you determine which of these camps people fall into? And just as a side note there, most people fall somewhere in between. So you'll have some really strong indicators for good health. You'll have some maybe minor indicators for weakness. And so overall, you'll be like an average person. Like, you have to take care of your body, but you're not like chronically sick or whatever. And that's where like 90% of people are going to fall into that, maybe 80%, 90%, something like that. And then you have the outliers, the extremes. And so we're going to be talking more about the extremes, but most of you will not be in those categories, just so you are aware of that. And most people that you work with, if you work with clients, will not be in those extreme categories. You'll just have, you know, that little bunch right there. And so there are three main things that I look at just to assess overall, just general indicators for health and wellness. Are they going to be strong and healthy? Are they more susceptible to illness? Do they have to pay more attention to these things? All of that. This isn't going to give you specific information about specific types of, you know, health issues or psychological issues or whatever. That's kind of a different thing, but it's going to give you that overall big picture for them. And so the first thing I look at and the most important thing I look at is the ascendant and the first house. So you want to look first and foremost at the condition of the ascendant, not only what sign it's in, but also, you know, are there planets aspecting the ascendant? What types of planets are aspecting the ascendant? Are they malefic planets like Saturn or Mars? Or are they benefic planets like Jupiter or Venus? Are they aspecting the ascendant in a way where it creates a hard angle? Is it a square? Is it an opposition? Is it a conjunction? Is it, you know, a sextile or a trine, something more supportive to the ascendant? So that would be the first thing that you would look at. People who have more malefic influences in challenging aspects to the ascendant might have more issues with their physical body, because the ascendant not only rules your personality, it rules your physical appearance and your physical body as a whole. And so that's something that's really important to look at. The ascendant rules the body. The first house shows different indicators related to the body and also personality and your goals and directions and orientation in life and all sorts of different things. Like I said, it's multi-tiered. There are a lot of layers there. And so if you maybe have somebody who has Mars poorly aspected on the ascendant, maybe they're more prone to accidents or injuries or acute illnesses or things like that. Again, it has to be activated and you need to have more than one indicator for this to really be true. But general things you would look at, or if you have maybe Jupiter on the ascendant or in the first house, and it's really positively aspected, maybe that person is going to enjoy better health. They're going to have much more vitality and strength, and they're not going to have to work as hard for it. The other thing I would look at in connection with that is, of course, the ascendant ruler. And so the ruler of the ascendant is the planet that rules the sign that occupies the first house where the ascendant is placed. And so sometimes there will be one ruler of the ascendant, because we have the traditional versus the modern rulership. So a lot of planets will just, or a lot of signs will just have one ruler. So like Aries is ruled by Mars, so you would look at Mars. Scorpio, on the other hand, used to be ruled by Mars. That's the traditional ruler. But now in modern times, it's associated with Pluto. And so in that case, I would look at both of those rulers. And depending on what sign, I would look at the traditional ruler more so than the modern, or the modern more so than the traditional, based on my own experience in working with charts and those energies. But that's kind of its own separate topic about traditional versus modern rulership, which maybe could be its own video later on down the line. But I would look at both, because they're both going to give you different types of information. So maybe they are a Scorpio rising and their Mars is super debilitated. And so they have health issues that come about, but their Pluto is super supportive, and Pluto is a very regenerative planet. And so, even when they are knocked down by a health crisis, they're very easily able to be very resilient and to power through it and to like heal very effectively. So you would want to look at both of those things. Another thing that you would look at is also the placement of that, the ruler of the ascendant in the different houses, because certain houses are considered to be more beneficial than others. And so the malefic houses are considered to be the second, sixth, eighth, and 12th houses. And so if somebody has the ruler of the ascendant in those houses, it's going to be a little bit more of a challenging energy. That doesn't necessarily always reflect in a health crisis. In the sixth house, maybe more so, there's going to be a lot of focus on health, or maybe even in the eighth. But it's not always that it's like a health issue. So just kind of be aware of that. But it does create a situation where that energy is experienced in a way that's more difficult, versus like the third, the fifth, the ninth, and the 11th. Those are like really great houses to have planets in, because they aspect the ascendant nicely. Or if you have them in the angular houses, it's going to be a more prominent energy, but that doesn't necessarily mean that it's good or bad. So you have to kind of look at that too. The other thing that you want to look at, moving on from the ascendant and the ruler of the ascendant and the first house and planets occupying the first house, that's something else I want to just kind of point out there before we move on, actually, is that planets that occupy the first house are important to look at. So I talked about malefic versus benefic planets, but in general, you want to look at which planets are in the first house and how are they aspected? What condition are they in based on the aspects to those planets from other planets? So do you have like the sun in the first house aspected by Jupiter in a positive way? That would be a good indicator for like vitality and energy and, you know, feeling good and healthy and maybe having more resilience, versus do you have the sun in the first house being squared by Mars and Pluto? That would be a different story. So and that could be the case for any planet. So you want to look at the planets that are in the house and what they're doing and who's interacting with them planet wise. The second thing you would want to look at is the condition of the sixth house and the sixth house ruler. So the sixth house in astrology is the house of health and daily health habits and routines. It has to do with things like nutrition and exercise routines and things like that as well. And so not only can this show you maybe what types of like dietary plans might be good for you, or especially what types of like routines in your day-to-day life for exercise and things like that, what would be best for you. You would look at Mars for those types of things too. There's a lot of stuff you would look at for this, but it can show you information about this, but it also gives you an indicator of your overall health and whether or not you might have challenges. And so if you have similar to the ascendant, the sixth house is maybe ruled by a planet that's really benefic. So maybe you have Sagittarius in the sixth house, which is ruled by Jupiter, and your Jupiter is nicely aspected. I use this example because I looked at Arnold Schwarzenegger's chart before I started recording this video, because I wanted to get a contrast to the chart that we're going to look at as an example, which is FDR's chart. And he obviously is somebody who had health issues. So I wanted to look at someone who is strong in their body. And what's interesting too about Arnold Schwarzenegger, as a side note, is that his ascendant ruler is the moon, and the moon is a general indicator of the body, which we'll get to, but it's also the ruler of his ascendant, and it's in square with Neptune, which could indicate issues with substance use or substance abuse, and he is known to have used steroids, right? But he has otherwise a lot of really positive energy around his health. He has a couple of difficult areas. So he's kind of more of a mixed bag, but he's somebody, if you think about somebody who's really strong, and he was a bodybuilder. And I could find his chart, actually. I looked up other famous bodybuilders and I couldn't find their charts because they're not like that level of famous usually. But anyway, so back to what I was saying here. So his sixth house is ruled by Sagittarius. He has Jupiter as the ruler of his sixth house, and it's in a trine with his ascendant and with some other planets. And so he has, it's also aspected negatively by other planets too. So there's a combination going on there. But the fact that it's, the benefic planet Jupiter indicates maybe more resilience, right? And so looking at the sixth house ruler and where it's placed and how it's aspected, that's going to give you a lot of information about somebody's overall health and, their experience there. And also looking at planets in the sixth house. So again, similar to looking at those first house planets, you want to look at what's going on with the planets that occupy the sixth house. Are they positive or negative planets? Are they benefic or malefic planets? And are they, aspected in a way that's positive or aspected in a way that's negative? Something else to take into consideration too that I should mention is that in traditional astrology, there's this concept of sect. If you're born during the day versus the night, different planets mean different things. And so one of the things you want to look at there in terms of the benefic versus the malefic planets are, if you're born during the day, Mars will be the most malefic planet and Jupiter will be the most benefic planet. So that just enhances that energy in a certain way. And if you're born at night, Saturn will be the most malefic planet and Venus will be the most benefic planet. So taking that into consideration too when you're assessing, malefic and benefic planets with the sixth in the first house, that could be something to look at as well. But looking at, okay, what planets are there? Is Jupiter and Venus in the sixth house positively aspected? Great. That indicates that you'll have really positive health outcomes and routines, and you might not have as much issue with that. Even if your body's weak, you'll be able to support it really easily, right? Even if that ascendant has issues, that sixth house is supporting you. And that's with your own personal habits and routines and maybe your experience with the healthcare system, finding the right physicians, all of that. It's more positive. Maybe you have difficult planets in the sixth house and you have really strong energy on the first house that supports a healthy body. But when you do have challenges with your health, it's more difficult to overcome because you don't know where to look, or you're not getting the right health regimens down or finding the right people. So that's something to kind of look at too. And then just in general, the sixth house is an indicator of health. So you kind of want to assess that in that regard too. Okay, finally, the third thing that I would look at as sort of just a supplemental energy is the condition of the moon. As I've mentioned before, in traditional astrology, the moon is a general significator of the body. I've only learned that a couple of years ago, and I actually noticed that with the moon, it could be indicative of certain like health crises or health outcomes because of working with hundreds of clients all over the world, and also looking at what was going on in my own life. I went through a period of time with Uranus squaring my moon on and off, on and off. I had an extra lengthy transit of that because of the retrograde cycles and the way that it just happened to line up in my chart. And every time it would come to pass, I would either have a really weird like health crisis. And I was like, why is the moon? I mean, it was squaring for my sixth house, so that was part of it. But I was like, why is the moon specifically triggering this? Or it would be a health crisis with one of my pets or a health crisis with my mom or like my grandmother or something. And so the moon is maternal figures. It's the mother. And it also rules dogs. And so it would be like my dog would have like a really weird health issue that is just completely started suddenly and nobody can figure out what the heck this is. That actually happened one of the times. Or, you know, she also got injured. And so anyway, so it was like, why is it showing up as that, right? And I was also seeing that with a lot of my clients, even if they didn't have a sixth house planet aspecting their moon like I did, I would see that, you know, sometimes with eclipses with the moon, it could bring some sort of health crisis or maybe even a turnaround. If they were already experiencing a health crisis, things would turn around in a positive way depending on what that eclipse looked like. So there were things like that I was noticing where I was like, there's some sort of connection here. And then I learned that that's actually a thing in traditional astrology. And so it became, you know, very clear as to why that was happening. So it was kind of cool. I was seeing this and I was already looking at it that way. And then it was validated by like ancient wisdom, which is always fun. And so that's another thing to look at is the condition of the moon. So is the moon poorly aspected? Is it nicely aspected? You know, what's going on there? And where is it placed, right? Where is it placed in the chart? There's one more thing that I've started to look at more as an experiment. And, you know, maybe you guys can play with this a little bit. So I wanted to mention it because it does seem to hold true when it comes to just assessing, again, the general overall health of the body and whether or not they're kind of like lucky in that way or if they have, you know, maybe some bad luck when it comes to their health. And that would be the lot of fortune. And in traditional astrology, the lot of fortune is associated with, you know, things that have to do with your body and your health and things like that, in addition to just kind of general good or bad luck, good fortune, that type of thing. And so the lot of fortune, something that I would look at for that is especially if it's being aspected or if it's in a conjunction with malefic versus benefic planets, that's something that I have seen actually be, I've seen that be associated with like either positive health outcomes or having more challenges. And so that's kind of just another thing to play with, to look at and to assess if you want to experiment with that in your own astrology studies and practice. It doesn't necessarily mean that it's definitely the thing. I've only been experimenting with it for a few months now, but it seems to hold true. And so I felt it was worth mentioning because maybe some people out there watching this have some additional insight that you want to share about that. And that's always fun to do. All right, so that is kind of the bulk of the sort of lecture portion of this video. And I did want to just pull up one chart, which is FDR's chart, which I mentioned before. So this is Franklin Delano Roosevelt. He was one of the United States presidents. Let me actually just get my screen. I'm gonna move this way so I'm like next to the image so I can like point at it. all right, so this is FDR's chart. And this is a good example of somebody who has a lot of energy around difficulty with health. And so I wanted to use this as an example of some of the things that we just talked about. On the opposite end, you can find someone who has really good health. I talked a little bit about Arnold Schwarzenegger. His is a little mixed, but he has a lot of really strong energy that's positive there too. And I don't really know very much about him and his biography and his health in general. I just know that he's a bodybuilder. He was using steroids at one point. That's about all I know about that. So I didn't want to pull that up as an example without doing a lot of research beforehand. But with FDR, we know exactly what happened to him. We know about his diagnosis. We know about the outcome. And we know the exact date when it started too, which is kind of cool. That's like a whole nother thing to explore if you're getting into that. But for him, so if you look at the ascendant in the first house, and I'm using whole sign houses, which is what I would use for this if I was assessing like a client's chart. So for the ascendant is in the sign of Virgo, which rules health and healing. So there's already an emphasis there. It's with Uranus, which doesn't always necessarily mean bad things. It can mean unexpected, crazy circumstances involving issues with the body, the appearance, health, or just kind of in general, your overall direction in life. It's changed in really crazy, unexpected ways. But it is being squared by Mars, and Mars is also squaring the ascendant. And Mars is actually, it's the lesser malefic planet for him because he's born technically at night after sundown, but it's still a malefic influence. It's a challenging influence. So he has a challenging influence to his ascendant and to a planet in his first house. So that's the first criteria there. What is the ruler of the ascendant doing? The ruler of the ascendant is Mercury. Mercury is in his sixth house of health, which indicates that a big focus in his life, a big theme in his life, is going to be his health. It's part of his identity, and it's part of how people know him, right? People know him as being the first disabled president, I think the only disabled president of the United States, and for, you know, having what they thought at the time was polio, which we now know was Guillain-Barre syndrome, but having polio and becoming paralyzed from the waist down. And so his Mercury is actually in a really tight square with Pluto. So that's a challenging aspect. It's in the sixth house of health, which indicates that that's a big focus for him. And I'm not going to get into all the specific details of what every little thing means, but in general, that's sort of an indicator of potentially having difficulties with health. He also has three other planets in his sixth house, or two other planets and Ceres. Ceres is its own topic, which we could talk about maybe later on if I do additional videos about medical astrology. But these three planets are in a sixth house of health, and they're all being squared by Saturn, Neptune, and also Jupiter, which is not necessarily the worst thing. But that Saturn and Neptune energy, with Saturn being the most malefic planet in his chart, being born at night, squaring his Venus, which is in the sixth house, squaring his Sun. He has Mercury as the ruler of the ascendant being squared by Pluto. Mercury also has some positive aspects. It has a really nice trine with Mars. And so it's kind of like health issues motivate him to take action, which is what occurred for him. He powered through it. Through his sheer like force of will, he recovered, and he used that experience to try to eradicate polio. So he was very determined and very like amped up and ambitious because of that. And also he was like, he still was like a very successful man. And overall, after that experience, he could have died, and he recovered almost completely from like where he was at his worst to, you know, just not having full use of his legs and, you know, having to deal with that disability. He still enjoyed a full, healthy, happy life. He still had a lot of success. And so he overcame all of that. So there is some strength there. His moon also is in a really nice sextile with Saturn, which is again resilience and determination, and you know, matters pertaining to the body. It's in a wide conjunction with Mars, which you might consider, but it's out of sign. But it's, you know, so it's, there's some positive energy there too. And then you look at his lot of fortune, which is in a wide out of sign conjunction with Saturn, which is just kind of something to pay attention to. But you can see here where he has a lot of really strong, challenging aspects and challenging energies with his health, but he was able to overcome that. And so that shows up in a few different ways. And the timing of this actually is really important too, because if he didn't have specific influences occurring in specific ways at that specific time, this might not have been activated in that way in his lifetime. So that's something else that you really have to consider. Even if you have a bunch of stuff like this in your chart, doesn't mean you're gonna have anything really crazy like Franklin Delano Roosevelt did. But again, it's just overall, is our health issues going to be sort of a focal point? Is he gonna have to work harder on his health, or is it going to be sort of just taking care of you? It's not going to be a big issue in his lifetime. And so for him, it was the former, but he was able to overcome it. And again, I don't want this to like scare anyone if they have things like this in their chart. It doesn't mean the exact same things will happen to you or anything like that, or that you'll even have a major health crisis. It's just, you know, this is something that you would assess if you're looking at their general overall health. You know, maybe this is someone who needs to support their body more and just take better care of themselves and just be more careful versus somebody who can get away with a little bit more indulgence or somebody who might be a really like strong, healthy bodybuilder, right? That's something that you could look at here too. So Hopefully you found that helpful and you found this information useful. If you have anything you want to add, your own insights, you can comment below. If you have questions, always I like reading your comments. I try to comment back to as many as possible, but it gets kind of hard sometimes. And if you like this video and you felt like it had value and you enjoyed watching it, please subscribe to my channel, like the video, share it with your friends, and thank you guys so much for watching this. This is kind of a fun video for me to do, and I've been wanting to do this for quite some time, and I have such wonderful, supportive people on my YouTube channel, and that makes it so much easier to feel comfortable kind of expanding, you know, beyond what I normally would be doing and talking a little bit about my personal experience too, which is always kind of scary to do on the internet like this. So you guys are always so wonderful and I'm super grateful. Not everybody has such wonderful viewers like you guys on their channel. I always get such nice, wonderful, supportive comments. And so thank you guys for being here. And I will see you guys next time. All right, bye everybody.